Hi, I thought I would supplement this blog article with a video. And in light of the video that I've shared, which is contrary to what I originally thought it was about, when I saw the title that BC woman with degenerative disease challenges assisted dying bill, I clicked it on thinking that, oh good, someone's opposing the assisted suicide bill. And at first it started out with this young lady named Julia Lam, has these, turns out, the same disability as I do. So I thought, hey, cool, she has spinal muscular atrophy. I'm guessing based on her symptoms, and well, just what she said, that she has type 2, I have type 3. I do have I had a nephew who's with Jesus now. He lived his short wee life for only 11 days, and then he had type 1. Spinal muscular atrophy is a genetic disorder or disease diagnosis that is caused by both parents having the defective gene. They've done enough research now that they actually can do blood tests to confirm that you have it, which I did have for fun, I guess, in that sense. When you've lived with it as long as I have, it was fun in the sense that just wanting to confirm, because I have been misdiagnosed before where they said I would be dead by the time I was 20. So it's hard not to, sometimes you gotta make light of something. So it wasn't fun in that sense, but I had to get the blood test to confirm that, yes, I do have SMA. Unfortunately, the test does not tell you what type you have. And type 3, of all the types to have, is the best. And I assume adult onset. I believe there's an adult onset one. So that would be obviously the best one. Type 3, life expectancy can be normal. Something I still have a hard time getting used to the idea of, because I didn't find that out until my early 20s, when I made it past 20 and finally got information on SMA. So this young lady, anyway, back to the topic, I forgive me, I do ramble and I can go on bunny trails. So sorry. But this Miss Julia Lam, or Ms. Julia Lam, was actually, as she's speaking about her great life and quality of life and all of that, since she was young, she was using her first wheelchair when she was 6. I personally turned off the video toward the end because I just got too frustrated. More than anything, it breaks my heart, actually. I was very disappointed as soon as I heard her, and I'm like, oh no, she's going to support the assisted suicide. So anyway, I guess what's happened, I've kind of stopped watching, I confess, the whole subject, because I can't tell you how much it saddens and infuriates me to hear people living with disabilities who want the right to die at any stage, at any time. I don't believe personally. I believe that only God has the right to choose when we live or die. He Psalm 139, read it. Yeah, it says it all there, along with other places in the Bible. Our life isn't ours to choose what to do with, as far as life and death, for anybody. I believe personally. And based on what the Bible says. So, and I have to testify to this, that because I've grown up with my disability, I have encountered many, many, many countless young people, children, toddlers, infants with various physical disabilities, have wonderful family members with autism spectrum, who are in the autism spectrum, wonderful people. I can't even imagine the thought that, how do you explain this kind of attitude about, I have the right to take my life if I want to. I'm this young lady here, I feel bad for her, I understand her fears, I have the same fears. Both of us, we may have type 2 and type 3, but the outcome could still be the same. I stopped walking myself, or using a wheelchair full time, when I was about 13, 14. I can't lift my arms beyond this hand. This is it. My other hand, this is it. It's down there. I don't know if you can see it. But so that's all I have function of. I can still swallow. I have inhaled food by accident a few times, noticing I'm having a bit of swallowing issues on occasion. I was set up for, actually, I have sleep apnea. So I'm supposed to be using a breathing tube, but it was so difficult to put on, I thought I'll just wait till the symptoms get really bad and I really need it. So that kind of stuff. So she's talking about a future of having those kinds of things, of respirators, G-tubes, where you're being fed with the tube. That can happen. It doesn't happen every single time when you have a SMA. it depends on the severity and all that, that type of thing. Again, it's like the flex on my ceiling that's all stippled with stipples. I say each case is different. There tends to be the symptoms, if the progression goes on long enough and you live to that point, it can go quicker for some, for sure. Type 2, way faster. Type 1, life expectancy isn't supposed to be past 2. But again, I've read stories where there's a young lady, I believe in Australia, who was like 16 and still alive, miraculously. So can you imagine the effect that it has? And I say this as someone who it affects. When I hear people who that you admire, people who fight it out, who have the dignity to live, to go through the pain, to go through the fears, to go through it all, to set an example for others, little children who are facing this same prognosis, and to see someone else sitting there, yeah, you know, I'm terrified and I want the right to choose to die. And I guess this new bill has made it clear that people who don't have terminal illnesses like we do, I guess we're actually all, just so everybody realizes this, if you haven't thought about it, the argument for assisted suicide is rather weak, in the sense that we're all dying, all of us. Some people will get hit by a car. Some people could drop dead of a heart attack. I mean, at a young age, I mean, we're all physically facing death. The good Lord has, thankfully, has a whole plan. The Bible, if you don't know, if you haven't checked it out, you don't have anything to lose. If you haven't read the Bible, it's all in there. The whole plan and everything, and God loves us. And so anyway, it takes so much more dignity for people who want to die. We know people who were in accidents, who faced illness, who wanted to die, mostly instant spinal cord injuries or head injuries and from accidents, who said that they wanted to die. There's a woman, Johnny Erickson Tata, and I strongly suggest looking her up. It's Johnny and Friends. She's been an encouragement and inspiration to me. She's broke her neck in 1967, and she was a Christian, but not, I guess, super committed. She faced, during rehabilitation and recovery, the temptation to want to die. She asked a friend to cut her wrists or something like that, and she went into a deep depression. But God took her through it. It caused her to depend on him. Her life is transformed. She has touched millions of people's lives, including mine, for the last, oh boy, since I was first watched the Johnny movie, where she plays herself. It's J-O-N-I. Just, you know, I strongly suggest watching it for encouragement and inspiration if you're struggling. So she has an organization called Johnny and Friends in California. And it's just amazing. So she wanted to die too. So, I mean, it's not abnormal to want to die. I definitely have prayed many, many, many times. And I know it's just the beginning. And I try to stop doing that, but I ask God, take me, Lord. I'm terrified of what awaits me if I make it past that. I talk to my husband like, oh, I won't be here next year, or this is my last year. I talk like that all the time. It's how I always have talked, because I've always been prepared for death. Because at the age of 7, I heard a doctor tell my mom that I was going to be dead by the time I was 20, because he misdiagnosed me as having a form of muscular dystrophy that you don't usually make it past 20. I had lots of friends who made it to make 13, 14, 15, 16. And it's usually pneumonia that will, they used to say that to me. It's not the disease that'll kill you, it's pneumonia. So I mean, the process anyway of SME, young ones with SMA, I recommend, there's a link that I'm going to put in this one as well, a very inspiring, moving link of a family who had 3 children with SMA and 2 children who don't. And just what they've gone through and what's going on now. It's actually very encouraging, inspiring. So you don't give up. I encourage Julia Lamb, who probably won't see this video, please don't give up. I know the fears. I know that the ability to, it affects all of your muscles except your involuntary muscles. And as far as I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, that's just your heart. Your heart is the only involuntary muscle. But I think the kids with the more severe type 1, I heard, watching a video where the lady did mention about the heart muscle. So as far as I believed, it didn't affect the heart muscle. I take it back. I might be wrong. The diaphragm, which is where you breathe, and when you breathe in and out, you could feel there's an arch type band muscle that goes across under your lungs and pushes up and down. That's voluntary / involuntary muscle. That's what weakens and causes things like pneumonia to be difficult to fight off. and to cough. Because I know for me, the last couple of coughs I've had where you could just feel that it takes every ounce of energy you have to cough. And yeah, so anyway, I know, as well, for me, one of my fears, I'm not sure about Julia Lamb. Thankfully, I don't know if she has scoliosis, but as a result of sitting in a wheelchair a lot when I was like 12, 13, more and more, because I was just down to using a walker and it being too difficult to walk, that I was sitting in a chair for so much without proper seating. From as far as I understand, that's what it was. I just had a plain cushion. So mental note, or to everybody who's new to using a wheelchair full time, young, old, whatever, especially young folks, because you're still growing, make sure you have proper seating and seating supports, because that's a secondary issue. So if you are new to using a wheelchair, you can develop scoliosis pretty bad. Your body gets all twisted up, your spine. And they told my parents at the end of grade 7, I was 13 years old, they said, yeah, she has to have surgery. She has an 80 degree S curve. It's like the letter S. It's a thoracic curve, which means that's in my chest area near the heart and lungs. The heart and lungs will collapse in 6 months if she doesn't have surgery. The ironic thing is, I lived in an institution at that time where there were medical professionals and physiotherapists. That's why I lived there, to access those services and go to an accessible school. Nobody noticed. Nobody said anything. So all of a sudden, I've got this life, never mind at that time, I still believed I had muscular dystrophy. And I'm going to die by the time I'm 20. But now I've got scoliosis so bad, I'm going to die it in 6 months. So whoosh, off we went before grade 8 to Sick Children's Hospital in Toronto. I had a Harrington rod procedure where they basically put a rod in the curve of the spine. It was about the thickness of the end of my pinky finger and about 10 inches long, roughly. Solid stainless steel. They put it in, they jack it up almost like, and then they use little chips of bone from my hip and fill in the whole spine. They wire up the rod once it's straight, as far as it can get the spine straight. It's not always 100%. My curve was severe. Actually, my spine is very, very curved. It's probably more than it ever was. So long and the short of it is it failed. At first, I got to be like 3 or 4 inches taller for a little while. Not too long. Slowly, it started going down, down, down. One day in one of those clinics where those people stare at you like you're a guinea pig, I bent down to pick up something back when I could do that. And my local orthopedic surgeon said, oh, you shouldn't be able to do that. I'm like, what? So he's like, you shouldn't be able to bend down. I'm like, oh, really? Okay. So that's when I realized that the fusion, it was supposed to be a full spinal fusion. Picture a brick wall where you use the mortar to build the wall, lay the bricks, put mortar in between, brace the wall, let's say a wooden brace, bracket, to let that wall harden and become one solid, perfectly straight wall that can, you know, stay on and not fall off or on someone's head. Well, with the scoliosis surgery, I had a back brace that I was supposed to wear for 6 whole months. I wasn't supposed to, I was supposed to be immobilized. My spine wasn't supposed to be like moving. So unfortunately, looking back, I think something, and this, hopefully someone could learn from this, if I know things have changed in like 30 years, so they probably do way better surgeries that work better maybe. But if they don't, just be careful. Take it seriously about moving around. They lowered me into a swimming pool. There's a therapeutic swimming pool at the place where I lived. And within no time, like we're not talking after the 6 months waiting period, they would lower me down on a stretcher and take off that back brace and lower me into the swimming pool. The swimming pool was my second home. It was a heated therapeutic swimming pool, and I loved swimming as it was. I was like a fish because it was like anti-gravity. You could float and do stuff. I did like my makeshift somersaults, my makeshift pretend synchronized swimming and all that stuff. No one told me not to move. Well, the fact that they took off my brace meant movement. So I'm pretty sure that's what, if you shook that brick wall while it was trying to cure or harden, you would have a wall that either crumbled or was really wobbly and would crash. So I can see why my Harrington rod procedure failed. And I think maybe that's why I looked it up. A lot of people's failed. But miraculously, I must say, my breathing is basically, I think, 80%. I've had pulmonary functions tests. And if you have concerns about breathing at all or breathing issues, ask your doctor and they'll do a pulmonary function test. But anyway, so my biggest fear, though, is because I haven't walked. When you don't walk, and I'm just saying this to compare to this other girl who actually wants the right to have someone help her die if she so chooses, because she knows what could await her, or may very well await her. I personally was diagnosed with osteopenia about 10, 15 years ago, which means my bones, it's like pre-osteoporosis, because I haven't walked. So when you don't weight bear, it's hard for your bones to build and be strong or density or something like that. So unfortunately, as it's awesome that I'm at 50. I love being 50. It's cool to say I'm 50. But it also means menopause. Yippee. I get to experience that, which I actually think is really cool that I get to experience all these aging things. I've got like gray hairs. They're starting to like be more than one at a time. It's so exciting. So anyway, one of the things though is when menopause hits, osteoporosis hits. So that's why they always warn women to, you know, have enough calcium. Make sure your bones are strong, ladies. Do not wait. So I'm not looking forward to the day. I have prayed, and I still pray. I assume that God will take me before I experience spontaneous fractures of my very letter S-shaped spine. In fact, an endocrinologist saw me one day and said, "What are you doing for your spine? I hope you're doing something for your spine." And I'm like, "Well, no, I was told I can't take calcium because I don't weigh bear, so there's no point." And he said, "Oh, that's not true." So there seems to be conflicting reports about that. I take calcium supplements along with vitamin D. As my doctor said, whether it's working or not, I don't know. I've tried things like Fosamax, there's bone building medications, but it's so hard on my stomach. I actually have almost drowned in stomach acid at night. So I can't take those bone building medications. So I know that it could happen. And I get sharp pains in my back, and I do take pain medications and nothing too major, but to help with aches and stuff, sharp pain, there's no pain medication for that. So, so he said that I could have spontaneous spinal fractures, and my mother, who doesn't have SMA, but has had osteoporosis, she's been taking a bone strengthening medication, and she's been okay. She did go through chemo, so that does weaken your bones. But even before that, she actually had a spontaneous spinal fracture, and has since had two more. And that's just from things like something about straightening a picture. But since she's been on the medication, it seems to have worked. But she had, her bones are so soft when she broke her ankle. Oh, that's a whole other story. Don't let me go there. Let's just say, keep your bones strong, ladies, when you're young. And then you won't regret it, because it affects, it can be painful. And spontaneous spinal fracture is not a good thing. But because I'm the letter S, I envision things like collapsing spine and crushing my heart and my lungs and suffocating. I mean, I get those kinds of thoughts. So this lady who talks about the fears of what's going to could come, that she's valued her life up until now and is still, you know, valuing her life, wants the right to die. Sadly, I say, don't give in to that temptation. Pray. I'm not saying you don't pray for God to take you. I guess if you don't believe in God, then I can see why the fears would be incredible. But I pray that you do believe in God. And anybody who's watching this, if you don't, I'd be praying that every single person who watches this, who doesn't believe in God, will cry out to him, the God of the Bible. He's real. He saved my life. Oh man, and I couldn't live without him. I wouldn't be here talking like this at all if it wasn't for him. So be encouraged, and you can watch that video. That's up to you. I post that link, and then the inspiring one. And then I thought I'd have to top it off with a counter kind of video, the opposite attitude, I guess, of this girl. So facing similar things, but stick it out. Not saying you don't want to die, but leave it up to God. And okay, take care. Thanks for watching if you made it to the end of this.